I'm here to see Praise Udoh. She's 12 years old and she's living with cerebral palsy. At the age of 6, she was asked to withdraw from her school because she has a disability. Cerebral palsy is a neurological disorder that is caused by damage to a part of the brain which controls the muscles. This damage may occur before birth, during birth, or the first few years of a child's life. This disability made Praise unable to use her hands effectively and her speech unclear.
When did you find out that Praise was different from other children?
When a child is born, from that 3 months, 4 months, you should start seeing the child making a move of effort of either to sit. Then 6 months at least, the child is supposed to start sitting or crawl. So I noticed all through that period, she would just lay on the ground like stick. She don't turn this way or turn this way. I keep on complaining, but people said all children are not the same. Because I complained that my children at 8 months, they are running, not even walking. They run at 8 months.
What do you think caused this?
We did a scan, I took to the man. He said the baby is dead, but it's weak. So they maybe operation, and the doctor was not there that night. So I was kept in the ward, not until midnight through God's intervention. I fell in labor. That was, I gave her to her. But she did not cry immediately. They tried all their effort, she didn't cry. Until after 2-3 days.
Two, three days?
Yes. He said.
Oh, she didn't cry for 2-3 days?
Yes.
Okay.
We're just admitted in the hospital. They were watching her. And later, we noticed she had jaundice. So they said, maybe because of that cry, she didn't cry.
So how did your daughter's disability and her inability to go to school for 6 years affect your life?
It affected me so much in the sense that I couldn't go out. I'm always with her and it's only this me. She must take her bed, she must eat, she must poo-poo, she must do this. It affected me much. Going out, I have to lock her inside and have to calculate the time when she will eat. And it affected me in many areas. I couldn't move on. Going out for one business or one marketing, I couldn't do.
So sir, when Praise was asked to leave school 6 years ago, what went through your mind?
I wasn't happy either, because I know the stage of which she is not the real conditions of her life. So I was not pleased about it. I felt that when she being in the school, she could be able at least reasons, and no matter what's happened, that the time will come, she will get out of the school and whatever thing to make her lives better.
How do you feel now that Praise is back to school?
Wow, I'm so happy. I'm now free to move, to at least go out for one something or the other. I need to gather money for a school, for whatever. I'm so happy. I'm very, very happy, and I thank God for that.
Looking at her, the evidence of her being in school is play out in her. She's okay academically, even her expression, despite the fact that she cannot discern herself close, she's better.
I've been told that Praise is back to school because of you. How did you accomplish that?
Praise left school after her nursery graduation, and that was when she was 6 years old. She left school, and now I was 18 then.
Wow.
And I was in 200 level in the university. And ever since then, we've always been, we had that idea that this cerebral palsy is a spiritual issue. We didn't even know it was cerebral palsy, just called cerebral palsy. We had this in mind that it's a spiritual issue, and so we're just praying basically. When she was advised to leave school, we just relaxed and we're praying, going to church and all, praying about the hoping that someday she'll start walking, she'll start talking. That was just it. So we'd get private lesson teachers, they'll come home to teach her and all. But she was not, Praise was not really comfortable with that. She was not okay with that. She wanted more. She wanted to go to school to meet with her friends. And she likes to learn. She's a very intelligent girl. Oh. So what happened was, when I was in the university, my mom kept calling, kept telling me about Praise, that we needed to find a way for her. So then I would just do little researches on how to get a wheelchair and how to move her around. But during my service year, that was when I really took this upon myself. There was a day my mom called me, she was not happy, and then she told me, we need to really look for a way. We need to look for a way, and we don't know what is wrong with Praise. She has been crying, she wants to go to school, she has really been disturbing, and my mom cannot go out. She needs different things. We just needed to find a way. So I went on Google, and then I searched. I typed for a child that cannot walk or talk or sit. And what came up was just cerebral palsy. Then we had not diagnosed just cerebral palsy. I had no idea about the name cerebral palsy. So I just started doing lots of research on it. So I went on Instagram, and because I used the hashtags a lot, I went on Instagram, I used the hashtag, and that was how I was able to get Mr. Biloba. I used the hashtag and it linked me to her page. So I sent her a message, and she arranged for a meeting. She came to our house. We talked, and she saw Praise, and she said, fine, she's going to take Praise back to school. She's going to look for a school around, and which she did. She got a school around, which we could afford at that time, though we could afford it anyway. But she got to school, and now Praise is in school.
Fantastic. So how do you feel about Praise being in school?
I'm so excited. At least I've been able to make her happy.
Yeah.
Because her happiness is very important at this time. She has always wanted to go back to school after her nursery education. So I've been able to achieve that part, and I'm so excited.
I was like, can she learn? And now, she's friendly.
I was like, was she able to cope in a normal class like this? But now, she's capable of everything we can do.
I was wondering, how will she be able to cope with other children without disabilities? But Praise have to move beyond my expectation. I'm so amazed. Let me use the word.
First of all, let me say this, that Praise is a wonderful child and a gift to be treasured and cherished. When she came in also, it was a bit difficult for us here. During the assessment, we saw a lot of things that would have put us back, but we took her. And since then till now, we have seen a lot of changes in her. When she came in, the first thing we noticed was with the speech, we couldn't hear Praise at all. Hearing her was a very difficult task. You need to come close, listen carefully, patient, a lot of patience with her. But today, the story is a different one. She speaks out. You could hear when she talks, and then she's able to tell you what she wants per time. So there have been a lot of difference, especially in her speech, the way she relates with people too. When she came, it was a bit difficult for her to relate with people, but today is a different story. Praise she's happy coming to school every day. Let me use that word. Praise is happy coming to school every day. For parents, I want to really appreciate God for the kind of parents God has sent to me. I sometimes say that they are angels in human form. I've never had any parents say no to children with disability. And maybe because of the first step we took, immediately we opened up the school, we made people coming in for inquiry understand that it is an inclusive school. In fact, there is a post just very close to the gatehouse. When you come in, that's the first post you will see that this is an inclusive school. So we make them know from the beginning. It is written outside at the signpost. It is written everywhere in the school that this is an inclusive school. We had the pupil contest for the position of president and vice president for the school council. And then Praise showed up that she was going to contest for the post of the vice president.
Vice president?
Oh yes, vice president. And then funny enough, the guy that was interviewing them didn't get her and then said that Praise was contesting for the post of the president. And she quickly said no, vice president.
So what position are you contesting for?
President.
She said president. You're not about principal, president. Vice president. You're not about principal.
And you see, this action put tears in the eyes of many that were seated yesterday. So I think for me, it was so amazing to know that a young girl like Praise actually knows what she wanted for herself. Yes, it's an inclusive world. So I would also advise every school to make their school an inclusive one.
I remember you called me a few months ago telling me about Praise.
Yeah.
That she had been sent out of school because she has a disability and she couldn't use her hands and therefore could not write. So what gave you the confidence that a child who could not use her hands, who could not write and whose speech was slurred could actually attend a mainstream school?
First of all, I mean, from my personal experience and from my experience in running my organization, the Let It Be Kids Learn Project, I had seen children with even more severe disabilities go to school and thrive. So meeting Praise and even realizing that even though she could not write, she could type with a phone, it just showed me that, you know, we were making too much of a fuss about writing. This girl is intelligent and she had no reason to be out of school simply because she couldn't write with pen and paper. Why do we, today in 2018, how many of us actually even write anything in longhand? So why would we now, you know, limit a child's ability to learn to the ability to write with pen and paper? I mean, for me, it was just really funny.
Why do you think a lot of mainstream schools don't accept children with disabilities?
I think that it's cultural, and I think that it's also it's cultural and societal. There are a lot of factors. So first of all, as a society, what we don't understand, we will stigmatize. Okay. So because we don't understand disability, over time, we have created different names for it and stigmatized it over the years. So you will find, you know, and again, people can go beyond what they know. So if as a school owner, all you know is what you heard growing up about how these children were, quote and unquote, a punishment from the gods because their parents offended the gods or something like that, you're going to carry that mindset into setting up your school. And so you would never really look at those children with disabilities as children that even should be seen in society. So it's all of that societal stigma. It's also, religion also plays a role. Because again, religion has also made it look like anything that isn't perfect is something that needs to be prayed away or cured or healed, and so if it's not healed, then something is wrong. Obviously, either the child is the problem or the parents don't have enough faith. So there's all of that drama surrounding it. And the truth is that we're all societal animals, and so if that's what society that the school owners are in is telling them, it would actually feed into the things and the policies that they build for their schools.
Okay. So in my own experience, I've realized that inclusive education is possible.
Yes.
And that it is not rocket science. I repeat, it is not rocket science.
Absolutely not.
So what is your advice to schools, mainstream schools that want to take in children with disabilities, but they don't know how?
So I always say that the first thing about inclusion that I say is that inclusion is an attitude. you first have to decide that you're going to override your natural thinking and say we want to do things differently, and then begin to seek for the house. And the truth is that the house are everywhere. If you ask the right questions, you get the right answers. My organization runs trainings for schools who want to move from where they are towards inclusion. It's kind of a crash course that can build into other trainings that can help the school to actually grow into an inclusive school. And like you said, it is not rocket science. Usually I say start with one child. You don't have to start with 50 children with special needs. Why don't you start with one child? And then begin to work with that one child. With that one child, what you gain is experience. What you begin to, it might be trial and error in the first, with the first one, two children, but what you gain after working with two children is what you can now document and call experience. By the time you get the third child, what you have is something that you've already tried and has worked, and then you can try it again. And then begin to now build confidence to continue to do it. So I think that first, you just start with an attitude that says, I'm going to do things differently. And then you can begin to move towards the future.
It took a young girl called Priscilla to grow up to understand that children with disability can and do go to school before her younger sister Praise could get an education. Otherwise, Praise may have lived her entire life uneducated because the schools around her vicinity refused to give her a chance. I would like to see more Priscillas in my world. I would like to see more schools embrace inclusive education. People and institutions that find solutions to disability management rather than shy away from it. What can you do to make the world a better place, you may ask? You may start by giving your children the right information about people living with disability. Disability is a medical condition, and people living with disability are not less human. Let's love without boundaries. Thank you.